Ash D'Souza for having agreed to pitch in the last moment. Like I was telling Alka earlier, he is my Man Friday, Saturday, Captain America, everything rolled into one. And again, thank you, Alka, for making the time and doing us the honor of chairing this session. I think all of you know Dr. Alka Subramanian, but nonetheless, she was very modest, as she usually is, in telling me not to waste time introducing her, but she does herself grave injustice by belittling herself. And she is, I'm proud to say, a dear friend and a fellow faculty at many forums. She is the associate professor at the BYL Hospital and TN Medical College. She has been awarded various fellowships and research awards. She is a prolific teacher, a prolific speaker. She is gradually gravitating towards a specialization in autism and the ASD spectrum. And she has, like I said to you, many awards to her credit, more than 70 publication index journals. She has been a member of various forums on various committees of the IPS. Now they're running out of committees where they can possibly do her justice. And the most important thing is that she's a very approachable person who is more than happy to lend a helping hand whenever you reach out to her, and that's something that endears her to all of us. So thank you very much, Alka, once again, and I hand over the proceedings of the evenings to you. You may start by introducing the speaker, and then you can take it forward the way you see fit. Entirely up to you. The ball is entirely on your side. The court, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rashmin. Thank you for having me here. It's always a pleasure to be associated with this series, because like I told Rashmin, it's a matter of pride that Mumbai has come up with this series, and he's done such wonderful work, and they've even won an award for it. About Avinash, well, he also didn't want any introduction, and he says that "Are PGs to mere ghar ke hain," which I'm very sure is true because all of you know him. But I will say one thing. I have known him since he was a resident, and he makes it a point to always say that I was a supervisor during his exams. But what a pleasure it is to have someone like that. When you're hosting an exam, is you should ask the other side. He's gone forward and done so much in psychiatry. He's a blue-blooded psychiatrist, by the way, because he comes from a family of psychiatrists. And he's not stopped short just because he's in private practice. That's what I find very amazing. He's gone ahead, he teaches, he has publications to his triple digits. He's one of the few psychiatrists I know who has an MPhil and PhD degree and is training people, is the editor of so many journals and much more, and has this boyish charm and exuberance and energy which he spreads everywhere. So it's a pleasure having you here, Avinash. And he's going to talk about something which is the foundation stone of modern psychiatry, as I call it, because if it wasn't for conversion disorders and Freud, we would still be talking about insanity. This is where we turned the page and we said, okay, let's look at it from a medical parlance. So without any further ado, let me not be between you and the speaker. And Avinash, over to you. Thank you for being here today this evening and pitching in to do this.
Yeah, I am just sharing my screen. Is my screen visible? Yes. Is the screen visible to everyone? Yes. Hello? Is the screen visible to everyone?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. 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 Fine. Well, the reason I chose this topic is because I felt it's a very important and relevant topic as far as psychiatry goes. But I think most importantly, conversion disorder, I think, is a disorder that has always intrigued us, always challenged us, always made us think as to why this happens. I'm going to approach it more from a postgraduate teaching perspective and also give you some personal insights that I have. Well, one of the things is that we all know what conversion disorder is. I'm sure most of you who are postgraduates have at some point of time seen a patient with conversion disorder. And it's a disorder where there is an illness or of symptoms or deficits which come up, where you have sensory or motor symptoms that come up. And we often say there are stressors that arise, you know, prior to the disorder setting in. We often stress and always tell patients, relatives, that the symptoms are not intentionally produced. They are not due to a substance. The gain is primarily psychological. You don't have a monetary gain in doing those things. And they all happen at a subconscious level. That's what we suggest. A better definition is that conversion disorder is a disturbance of bodily function, which does not conform to the current concepts of neurological anatomy and physiology. So very often when we see the patient and we see the symptoms and we say this cannot be explained neurologically, there is no pathway to explain this. There is no medical reason to explain this. And we very often take a history and find there is some setting of stress or there's some setting of dysfunction that we see. And it's very important that we have these psychological factors when we diagnose conversion disorder. The reason why conversion disorder is a very important disorder is because if you treat conversion and you treat it well, in practice, in any psychiatric career that you're in, it will be regarded as, you know, your success as a psychiatrist, because it's a very tough disorder and it's a very challenging disorder. It's a disorder that stems from the early concept of hysteria. And Sigmund Freud was a person who introduced the term conversion for the first time based on a patient he had who was named Anna O. And he said that conversion reflects symptoms which are based on unconscious conflict. Now, it's very interesting to understand that the word hysteria is not used anymore, but it was the earlier term which was used for conversion disorder. And hysteria was derived from the word hysteros, which means wandering uterus. They used to believe that the symptoms were seen more in young women, and these arose due to probably hormonal disturbances or some kind of sexual stress or some kind of stress that wherein the uterus moved around the body and produced these symptoms. This was the ancient thinking. But what was very important is this got replaced because Freud is the one who restored dignity to the diagnosis of conversion disorder. And he believed that a conversion disorder is something that occurs at a subconscious level, because when you have things that you can't deal with, when you have stresses that you can't deal with, when you have issues that you can't handle, probably your ego, the conscious part of your mind that sort of, you know, uses a defense mechanism called conversion, which converts your conflicts into a symptom, a physical symptom. And that symptom may not be explainable medically, but it converts it into a physical symptom. And that's what causes the conversion of a psychological conflict into a physical symptom is what we term as conversion. What's very important to understand is we also use the word functional, very common for conversion disorder. There are a lot of general practitioners, physicians will very often send you a patient and say, I think he or she is functional. What we mean by functional in conversion disorder is that the symptoms are present, but there is no structural damage. There is no structural abnormality that you see. That's why the problem is one of functioning of a particular organ or body system. So that's why the word functional has come in. And if you look at this slide, Freud proposed a different mechanism in which he said that unwelcome experiences which are repressed in the unconscious, they get converted into physical symptoms. And he spoke about his patient and he said she repressed her erotic idea and transformed the amount of its affect into the physical sensations of pain. He argued that though the repression was deliberate, in order to escape from distress, which he called the primary gain, the conversion was not. He said the splitting of consciousness is an intentional one, and the actual outcome is different from what the subject intended. The symptoms are very different from what the subject thought. We all talk about DSM criteria, so I'm just going to run through this because in an exam setting, you may be asked about this. DSM-4-TR labeled this as conversion disorder. It came under the dissociative group of disorders in ICD-10. And normally, it was seen that comorbid dissociative disorders occurred in approximately 30% of patients with a DSM-4-TR conversion. What I have put below is the DSM-5 criteria, and they call it functional neurological symptom disorder. And it's they've removed the term conversion. They believe one or more symptoms are present that either affect voluntary motor or sensory functions to cause a loss of consciousness. The symptom is found not due to a general medical condition, but what's very, very important is the symptom after appropriate medical assessment. That means the patient has to undergo a series of medical assessments. You rule out that there's no general medical condition. You rule out there's no substance-induced phenomena, and you rule out it's not a culturally sanctioned behavior. Also, one or more diagnostic features are present to provide the evidence of incongruity with a recognized neurological or medical disorder. That means the condition can't be explained medically, and the symptom causes distress, of course, socially, occupationally, and in important. The notes in DSM-5 are very important. A relevant psychological stressor is often present, but is not a requirement to establish the diagnosis. This is very important because a number of times we talk to these patients, we continuously try to find out if there is a stressor, and we're not able to find it. So the relevant psychological stressor is not a requirement. And also, malingered or feigned symptoms are not considered functional. So what's very important is that if you feel that it's being done for money, it's being done for property, it's being done for compensation, and these are feigned symptoms, then you can't diagnose as conversion disorder. But what's very important is, let me tell you a very important facet is, discovering feigning is very difficult. And proving its absence is far more difficult. You know, you can't prove that someone is not feigning. It's very difficult to say that. So therefore, they mentioned that proving the absence of feigning is not a requirement for the diagnosis. This is something which is, I think, very important that you have to understand. So there are four key diagnostic features of conversion disorder. One is neurological symptoms that involve motor or sensory or a loss of consciousness. There's no evidence of organic conditions. There are associated stressors, though not needed. And feigning is excluded, though again, this is not needed, but this is just for you to know. Conversion disorders are probably very common. I think in our hospitals, probably 5 to 10% of patients present with it. 25 to 30% of patients in certain studies. The range in the general population ranges from 11 to 300 per 1 lakh. So it varies across studies. So that's there. They believe that 20 to 25% of patients admitted to a general medical hospital may have conversion symptoms at some point of time. And 24% they believe in a study done that had at least one conversion symptom. What's very important to understand is you may not always have a diagnosis of conversion disorder, but you may have some patients that present with conversion symptoms. If you look at the ratio of women to men, you'll find it's more common in women. There's an increased female predominance in children also. The symptoms in women, they believe, are more common on the left side of the body, though personally, I think it's there all over. Women with conversion symptoms are more likely to develop somatization also. In association in men, it's been found between conversion and ASPD, though it's rare. And men with conversion are often found to be involved in occupational or military accidents. So these are just epidemiological facts. The onset can occur at any age, though it is seen in childhood also, but rare before the age of 10. It's rare after the age of 35 or 40, but it has been reported in old age also. So it's not that it isn't common at all. The common phase is post the age of 10, 10 to 35 is a common age range that you see it. And also it's very important is when a person has some medical conditions, comorbid with that, you may see conversion symptoms sometimes in middle age or old age. Commonly, you see it in rural populations, in developing nations. I have spoken to a number of my psychiatrist friends who are practicing in rural areas, and they say that they see a lot of conversion there. Of course, we see it in Bombay also. I think we see it in, I see it at Sion, people see it all over. And we see it in private practice, so it's there all over. So generally, a family history of conversion is often present. What's very important is that cultural norms are important considerations. So the behaviors are not culturally sanctioned. So they're not, you won't diagnose a case of possession as conversion. You won't diagnose some religious trance as conversion. These are things which are very important to understand. What are the common psychiatric conditions that you see with conversion? Depression, anxiety, somatization. You all know it is combined. Always remember, conversion is uncommon in schizophrenia, but around 1/4 of admissions to a psychiatric unit for conversion may have a masked mood disorder or schizophrenia. This is something which is a very important thing I want people to remember. A lot of patients with around 20% of patients with psychosis sometimes may have a conversion symptom which they present with. You may try to treat as conversion, the patient may not show improvement. Think of whether you missed a depression disorder or whether you missed a schizophrenia process and treat accordingly. Around 5 to 20% of patients have histrionic personality. We all know what that means. 9 to 40% of them probably have passive aggressive personality, which is also seen. Conversion is also commonly seen in antisocial personality. Now, one important facet to understand is that you don't see conversion so commonly in borderline personality as much as you see it in antisocial. So this is something which is very important. And medical and specifically neurological disorders may be there in these patients also. What are the causes of conversion disorder? So far, we haven't been able to elucidate good biological theories for it. So far, we haven't been able to elucidate a biological brain-based pathway for conversion. Our knowledge has been based on psychoanalytical theories, learning theories. So psychoanalytical factors in conversion are repression of the unconscious conflict. So there is either some aggression, some sexuality, some prohibition of expression, etc., that is seen. And when you look at conversion disorder, I think one of the most important facets that probably come up is that there is some aggression towards a parent, there is aggression by a daughter-in-law towards the mother-in-law. Sometimes there may be sexual expression which is prohibited, there may be a failed love affair, multiple things that come up. So basically, you convert the anxiety into a physical symptom. The symptom binds the anxiety. That's what the book says. And they allow partial, though disguised, expression of the forbidden wish or urge. So you avoid a conscious confrontation with those impulses. So you develop the symptom so that your urge may be expressed. And the conversion disorder symptom has a symbolic relation to the unconscious conflict. For example, you may see vaginismus-like symptoms in patients with sexual issues. You may see syncope with arousal, paralysis with anger. So there is some symbolic confrontation, blindness, if they have seen something out of the way. And the symptoms communicate the need for treatment, and the individual may derive a secondary gain. Now, what's very important is to understand the concept of primary gain and secondary gain in conversion. We'll come back to it later, but primary gain primarily means that the anxiety associated with the symptom is done away with. You convert the symptom into a physical symptom, so the anxiety goes away. The secondary gain is that you have a non-verbal means of controlling others. You get more attention, more love, and you are forgiven for a lot of wrong that you may do. So that is something which is there. When we look at learning theory, learning theory states that conversion disorder is a conditionally learned behavior. That's the way of reacting to certain stress and symptoms which you learn early in life. That's your means of coping. And there's a presence of a conversion model. What I mean by this is there's somebody in the family that has conversion, and that presence of a conversion model makes you learn the process of conversion. That is a learning theory. There are a lot of biological theories that have been put forward. I'm not really going to go into too many details here because I feel the clinical issues are far more important. So you may see some brain imaging. So there is hypometabolism of, say, the dominant hemisphere that has been shown in some studies, hypermetabolism of the non-dominant hemisphere, feedback between the two hemispheres, which is impaired. But we don't really have any proper theory for conversion from a neurobiological perspective. There's an increased incidence of conversion with organic disorders. That is something which is known. This is just to explain to you that hypermetabolism of the non-dominant hemisphere results in cortical arousal that causes negative feedback loops that can lead to conversion at times. What are the common clinical features of conversion? And this is something which I think is very important because all of you at some point of time are going to see patients with conversion disorder. The commonest conditions you see conversion with are paralysis, blindness, and mutism. Now, sensory symptoms are very, very common. So you will see sensory modalities which are affected. Anesthesia and paresthesia in the extremities. I always remember seeing a young girl in her 20s who presented with anesthesia, particularly hemianesthesia, and the neurologist had ruled out that there's no brain lesion. The MRI was normal. The neurological examination was normal. And she had an altercation with her mother-in-law, and the altercation with her mother-in-law resulted in her trying to hit the mother-in-law. And these symptoms of paralysis developed immediately after that. So there was some stressor, some anger that led to this paralysis coming on. You may also have patients who develop blindness or tunnel vision or deafness, which is unilateral or bilateral. I always remember seeing a 26-year-old boy who presented with blindness, which was ruled out because the visual evoked potential tests were normal. They did an ERG, electroretinogram, which was normal. They did some other tests which said he couldn't be blind, and they believed that this was totally functional or conversion disorder like. And when we spoke to the boy under anesthesia in a pentothal interview, he revealed that I think he walked in and he walked in on his sister who was changing her clothes, and he was sort of aroused on seeing her. There was a huge amount of guilt related to that, and that is what led to the conversion blindness presenting. So very often conversion patients with blindness have pupils which are reactive to light. They have normal evoked potentials and they walk around. Though he was blind, he never collided. He never fell down. He would even be able to be blind but walk down the stairs without missing a step. So that was another thing that proved, you know, went in that favor. Sometimes we have motor symptoms. So abnormal gait and weakness and paralysis, which is there. I always remember a girl who presented to me when I was a resident. She was a 16-year-old girl who was in the 17-year-old girl in the 12th standard who presented with paralysis below the waist. And the neurologist said that this is primarily conversion. And we had admitted her in our ward, and she would say, I can't walk. But she was able to sit cross-legged, though she was not able to walk. The moment you would get her out of her bed, she would fall down. And I remember during the rounds, many of you probably would, you know, miss out on having learned from people like Dr. Jayant Apte, and we had Dr. Apte who was on the rounds. And he, you know, immediately threw something at her, and she was able to move, moving her hips, moving her legs, moving everything. And he said that, you know, this proves that it isn't, you know, that reflex was still present. And she also had what we refer to as the astasia abasia. If you see it once in your life, you'll never forget it. It is a staggering gait where there is irregular jerky movements. You feel you're going to fall, but the person doesn't fall. So this was seen in that case. Reflexes were normal when we examined the patient. No muscular atrophy was seen. And we also got an EMG done for that patient, which was absolutely normal. Pseudo seizures is another very important area of conversion. And it's very, very important that you rule out real seizure disorder, because you have to rule out epilepsy. What's very important is you may not see tongue bite. You may not see urinary incontinence. You may not see injuries. The person, the seizure sometimes may be mimicked accurately. We have seen pseudo seizures in children who have patients with seizure disorder in their house. So they mimic the seizure accurately. You also see a large amount of pseudo seizures in patients who already have epilepsy. So one has to know that pseudo seizures can coexist with epilepsy, and it's a very common childhood form, adolescent form of conversion. So one has to, you know, probably look at that. Pseudo seizures is a very interesting area, and I think the gold standard for diagnosis is doing a video EEG. So you do a video EEG and the person gets a seizure, it will show a muscle artifact, versus if you actually had a true seizure, it would show seizure activity. That's the gold standard for you to diagnose, but even clinically, you can diagnose in those cases. We already spoke about primary gain and secondary gain. There's also something called labile indifference, which primarily means that the patient is not bothered about his symptoms. He doesn't really care whether he's recovering or not recovering, and to what extent is he ill. Normally, patients would be worried about a paralysis, but he isn't. There is also identification. They have identified with some role model that they have seen. We've already expressed what primary gain and secondary gain is. Yes, the identification means that there's an unconscious modeling of symptoms after someone is considered important to the patient. You may see that in symptoms with someone who has died recently, a conversion model in the house. Labile indifference, we said that you have an inappropriate cavalier attitude towards serious symptoms. Now, you may not always see it in every patient. Conversion disorder, we have no specific standard laboratory tests, but we have a huge amount of clinical examination that can be done. You can do a lot of psychophysiological tests that give you an idea whether conversion is present or not present. So when you have a patient that presents with neurological symptoms, which is not explainable neurologically or medically, you rule out all organic causes. Look at social factors that may be present, look at environmental factors that may be present, look at psychological factors that may be present, look at some biological factors that may be present, and comorbidities before you diagnose conversion disorder. What's very important is that you have to have a triggering event. You have to have perpetuating factors like impaired emotional processing, accumulation of stressors. You have risk factors like family factors, social factors, genetic factors that all lead to the conversion reaction. What's very, very important, I spoke about video EEG already, but you have to rule out various other conditions. There's a large number of differential diagnoses for conversion. I'm not going to go into these details. The slides will be available with the organizers and they'll put it up on the website and you can have a look. So you rule out all neurological conditions. You rule out other psychiatric disorders, though you may have comorbid psychiatric disorders, which are there. One thing which I want to mention is in schizophrenia, sometimes you may have that hallucinations that may present at times with conversion-like symptoms. So you may see conversion-like symptoms in patients with depression and schizophrenia. You may see conversion and somatization occurring together. You may see conversion and hypochondriasis occurring together, conversion and pain-related disorders occurring together, and sexual dysfunction and conversion that occurs together. So remember that. We rule out malingering and factitious disorder. I'm not going to cover this because this is beyond today's domain. What's very important is that, yes, you will do visual field testing. You may sometimes see tunnel vision. Sometimes you may see vision, visual fields not in keeping with blindness. When you have monocular blindness, the swinging flashlight sign, the Marcus gun pupil sign, where you will see contraction of the pupils in response to light, you do a visual evoked potentials that will be seen. Similarly, in bilateral blindness, if you test coordination, you may be able to test it properly. Touching the index finger, touching the fingers of the hand may all be very easy. If a person presents with aphonia, that is a lack of speech, you may request a cough and it may be easily done. You will observe if the patient has intractable sneezing. In coma, there is something known as the oculocephalic maneuver that you may try, wherein the examiner tries to open the eyes and move the patient's head from side to side. The eyes also move, which you may not see in normal coma. It can also happen that when the patient has anesthesia, the anesthesia is not in a manner of how our dermatomes, skin dermatomes, would exist. In hemianesthesia, there's a very strict midline anesthesia, which is not common in neurological conditions. The asthesia abasia gate I have already described. In paralysis or paresis, sometimes if you try to drop the hand on the face, it doesn't fall on the face if it's conversion. But in a true paralysis, it would fall on the face. There is something known as the Hoover test that in a case of conversion, when you try to sort of lift the limb, which is paralyzed, you'll find that the opposite limb exerts a pressure, downward pressure on your hand. All of you who have been in undergraduate medicine and have read books like P.J. Mehta and Golwala have a mention of this Hoover's test over there. Motor strength is absolutely fine. So initially, conversion disorder is a tough disorder to treat. The symptoms resolve within a few days to maybe over a month. 75% of patients have no further episodes, though 20 to 25% of patients have recurrent episodes, which make it all the more problem. 25 to 50% later present with medical conditions or neurological disorders that affect the nervous system. Predictors of a good prognosis in conversion: sudden onset, you identify the stressor, a good premorbid personality, no other disorders, no other stressors, short duration, good intelligence. Tremors and seizures have a poorer prognosis than paralysis or blindness, that has been noted. How do you manage or treat? Well, I think a lot of reassurance and appropriate rehab is very, very important. We don't really have medications to treat conversion, except that we treat the underlying symptoms. So we treat anxiety with anti-anxiety medications like benzodiazepines. We treat the depressive features with an antidepressant of your choice. But a lot of therapy is very, very important. Though they say psychotherapy and the development of transference is very high in patients with conversion. So you have to be a little careful when you look at starting psychotherapy in patients with conversion. Because patients with conversion disorder may be less open to psychological explanations, the groundwork for a discussion has to be approached very carefully. So do not inform the patient of diagnosis on the first encounter. Very, very important. Reassure the patient that the symptoms are very real, but we do not have a diagnosis. Avoid giving the patient an impression that you feel nothing is wrong with him. This is very important. Don't let your hospital staff also make the patient feel that you are not interested in him. Provide socially acceptable examples of diseases that are stress-related. So talk about blood pressure, diabetes, multiple disorders which are stress-related and his symptoms. Provide common examples of producing symptoms like heart racing when you ask someone out, a queasy stomach when talking in front of the audience. Provide examples of how subconscious influences the behavior, like nail biting, foot tapping, pacing, etc. Emphasize that the symptoms are reversible. Very important. Patients can be told that their bodies are not functioning properly and there's no structural damage and that the symptoms are reversible. Explain to the relatives that understanding and accepting the diagnosis would lead to improvement. Because rather than stuck and wondering about what is wrong. So this is something which I feel is very important when it comes to patients with conversion. You will have to treat the psychiatric problem. You may do an amlobarbital or a phenobarbital interview, which does help in many cases. Therapy really is insight-oriented therapy. You explain to them what the disorder is. Relationship with a caring and a confident therapist is very, very important. Confrontations regarding symptoms being imaginary is detrimental. Don't try to do that. Focus on stress and coping, which is very important. Explore their intrapsychic conflicts and try to find out whether there's a symbolism of their conversion symptoms. This is something which is very important. What's very important and you have to answer in conversion disorder is that, is conversion disorder always distinguishable from neurological disorders? Well, it is. You have to try and, you know, find out whether there's an existing neurological condition or not. There are a lot of psychophysiological tests that can be done, which will help you distinguish. Diagnose conversion disorder with a lot of thought and caution. The reason I say that is because once you diagnose a patient with conversion, wherever he goes, his physical symptoms, even though real, are never taken seriously. Lot of medical personnel will then try to diagnose him as having conversion, treat him as having conversion, and will keep saying that he has conversion. And that would cause a lot of distress to the patient. Are there specific stressors in conversion disorder? This is very important. Is money always a stressor? Is sexual issues always a stressor? Is family life always a stressor? We really don't know. The stressor varies patient to patient. So we don't really have specific stressors in conversion disorder. This is something which is important. Also, is there a need for a temporal association between the stressor? Now, this is very important for you to know, because you may not always have a stressor that is present 1 month, 15 days, 1 week prior to the conversion. The stressor may have been ongoing for the last 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, and conversion may now be a mechanism by which the patient deals with it. So you may not always have a temporal association between the stressor and conversion. Are risk factors enough, or there have to be triggers? No, risk factors are also enough for conversion. This is something which is important to understand. A past history of conversion, having a family history of the same conversion model is enough. Even child sexual abuse and childhood trauma is enough for conversion to occur. You don't necessarily have to have ongoing stressors. No, not necessarily at all. Remember that epilepsy and conversion disorder are very common together. So any patient with epilepsy, you may see pseudo seizures. Conversion symptoms are also very common in psychiatry. So you may see depression patients who present with a few conversion symptoms. You may have patients with anxiety that present with a few conversion symptoms. So these are some things which are very important to know, that you may not always have a diagnosis of conversion disorder, but conversion symptoms may also be there. Conversion is very common in children and adolescents also. Exam stresses, a strict teacher, violence in the house, divorce in the family, multiple factors can lead to conversion in the pediatric population. So one has to be very gentle when dealing with this population. It's very, very important that you deal with them in a very gentle manner. Psychoeducation of the family is also a must. You have to psychoeducate them and make them understand that, yes, you know, conversion is something that is, you know, a disorder which is not being done. Very often the relatives say, kya hamara patient natak kar raha hai? It's very important that you make them understand, no, there's no, natak which is happening here. Rather, it's a disorder that's happening, and it's happening at a subconscious level. You also have to rule out feigning, malingering in patients with conversion, though it's very difficult to rule out. There's no way you can probably rule that out always. That's all I had to say about conversion. Before I end, I just want to say that this is my email ID. I thank Rashmin for, of course, inviting me here and allowing me to share my thoughts with you. I'm keeping around 10 to 15 minutes for whatever questions you may want to ask. I just want to mention here, since we are talking to a postgraduate group, that if any of you are interested in writing papers, chapters, you want to expand your publication list and you want to collaborate with me, I'm more than happy. I'm on an open forum telling you that as a person who writes, I'm never really eager to have my name as a first author. So I always give my residents the chance to have their name as a first author so that you get more credit in your CV than I do. I'm also associated with two journals, the Indian Journal of Mental Health and the Annals of Indian Psychiatry, which is a West Zone journal. So if you want any papers that you would like to have published there, which could help you from a CV perspective, my email ID is here. Just email me and get in touch with me, and I'll be more than happy to be of any help I can to all of you. Okay. Thank you. And I'll just stop sharing, and then I'll leave this on for some time, and then we can take up questions.
Yes. Thank you, Avinash, for a very comprehensive and yet so precise overview of conversion disorders, which actually, if one chooses to, you can go on for days. And if there are any questions, or you can put them in the chat box. So I'm going to ask you a question while the PGs sit and think, Avinash.
Yeah.
What about conversion and schizophrenia? Is there any relation between the two? And if so, yes, when, how?
Yes. So now there are two theories to this. There was at one time an old classification for schizophrenia, which was proposed by someone called Leonard, who had spoken about hysteroid psychosis at one time. And he mentioned that you may sometimes see conversion symptoms in patients who actually are psychotic and they present with conversion symptoms. You try to treat them as conversion disorder. They don't improve. And finally, you realize that they break down into a psychotic process. So that was the first theory. The second theory is that many patients with schizophrenia in the recovery phase, you know, when they realize and they develop an insight that, you know, I'm having schizophrenia and oh, all this has happened, like we say, the depressive features that come in during the insight phase may tend to present with conversion symptoms to deal with their own guilt and their own stress at that point of time. So you may see it at that stage. And thirdly, you may see conversion sometimes as a symptom of schizophrenia when they are breaking down into psychosis, because you may not really, you know, they may not understand what's going on and the anxiety gets overwhelming. And conversion may be a defense mechanism used for a few months before they break down into a full-blown psychosis.
So for the PGs, that's really very important to know that you could have an overlap. Usually we would always think that conversion is purely neurotic and you do not have an overlap with schizophrenia, but you often do see, particularly at these two peaks, when there is resolution and when there is breakdown, that we find often the patient also has conversion and you're thinking of a dual diagnosis, but it's part of the whole process. Okay, now we have a few questions which have come up. Prakash Jain is asking you that it's often seen that patients with depressive features secondary to stressors, but DSM criteria mention that it must not be explained by any other psychiatric disorder. So how do we tackle this? What diagnosis do we give? Do we give a dual diagnosis because DSM does not allow the same? And this is a very common challenge that we see while documenting it.
Okay, now I will give you a personal viewpoint and a theoretical viewpoint here. Every psychiatric disorder has some stressors. So that is what I firmly believe and we've all seen clinically. Another thing that I would tell, I think, postgraduates particularly, and something that I have learned over the last two decades of my practice, is that you can't fit patients into DSM boxes. You know, it doesn't happen that way. So I don't necessarily say that the DSM criteria are wrong, or I'm not saying that don't follow them. They are guidelines to help us diagnose. But you will always have patients who you need to treat who may not fit into criteria. Like, just because a patient doesn't have the 2-week symptom criteria for MDD, it doesn't mean you don't treat him with antidepressants because, you know, you say, okay, now you wait 2 weeks, let me put you into MDD, and then I start treating you. No. So treatment and symptom management is paramount. Diagnosis will always come in. So I would say, don't really go blind with the DSM thing, follow it, but you will have variations above and beyond it that will happen. So I think start treatment. Don't worry about, you know, fitting. You can always, we've learned in an era where we've had our teachers always tell us that the clinical diagnosis and the clinical formulation is far more important than just meeting DSM criteria.
Yes. So basically, if you're talking about from an exam perspective, you're going to stick to whatever your guidelines say. But do not try and screw a patient, as I say, into the DSM. Please, these are for us to understand and treat the patients, but it's not hard and fast. So when you're approaching the patient, keep all that in the back of your mind, just like what Avinash says. Okay, now we have another question over here, and it is, how do you manage a patient of schizophrenia who is in partial remission and has conversion symptoms?
Well, I think you have to first look at how much is the recovery from a schizophrenia perspective. So your schizophrenia prescription treatment continues side by side. And then you try and understand why the conversion has come up. Has it come up of new stressors? Sometimes it could just be that a patient with schizophrenia has not been working and suddenly now has to, you know, take up employment since he's recovered. And the stress of a new job can lead to conversion symptoms, or the stress of a new boss. So you try and elucidate those stressors and work on that from a therapeutic perspective. You may have to add an anti-anxiety or an antidepressant based on what are his underlying symptoms. But you work from a therapeutic perspective, just as you would treat any other conversion symptom. And the two treatments go side by side. You don't alter the antipsychotic maintenance prescription. You let that continue side by side.
Do you need to add an antidepressant?
Yes, I mentioned based on the underlying symptoms. If there are more depressive features, you may add an antidepressant. If there are more anxiety and panic features, you may add an anti-anxiety or a benzodiazepine based on what you feel.
You first want to optimally treat the schizophrenia before you jump to that.
Yes,
right?
Yes, definitely, yes.
So I think that clears that question. And Kashish Thapar has asked, why is dissociative amnesia in dissociative spectrum and other neurological symptoms in functional neurological disorders in DSM-5 a dimensional classification?
Well, Kashish, that's a good question. But what's important to understand is that dissociation is an entirely different phenomena, and conversion is an entirely different phenomena. And very often, if you look at dissociation from a psychodynamic perspective, there is a total splitting of the personality into two. And amnesia is, while we say, yes, memory loss is a neurological symptom, dissociative amnesia does not have a neurological basis. Whereas here, we are looking at neurological symptoms which can be explained medically, and which at times, the symptoms are medically possible. For example, numbness, paralysis are possible medically. But the pathway, like the patient, the manner in which the patient presents with these symptoms are not explainable medically. That's what is the basis of functional neurological symptoms. And that is why that comes under the rubric of conversion. And they've also put dissociation separately. It's always been a separate classification because there are a huge amount of cultural factors that also come into the dissociation spectrum, which, doesn't come under conversion. And let me tell you, dissociative amnesia is far, far rare compared to conversion.
True. That's true. What about, Praveen Navkare says it was a lovely lecture, and please can you elaborate on pentothal interview, like doses, approach, etc.?
Well, I think, for pentothal interview, what's very important is first you need to have an anesthetist who is adept at, doing it and who probably has an idea how to do it, because the patient has to go into a level where he's awake, not very doped, not very drowsy, and at the same time able to answer you. The Pentothal interview lasts around 15 to 20 minutes, 25 minutes, depending on how long you want it to go and how responsive the patient is. Sometimes a patient may get very anxious or panicky during a Pentothal interview, so you need to have some medication on standby to help him if that happens. The approach is generally thrice a week, maybe alternate days, just like you do an ECT course, you do it thrice a day, twice a week, till you probably feel, okay, it's not working anymore, or we're not able to get more information. If you get information, you may even do it daily for the first 2-3 days and then follow it up with gaps. So that depends on how much information you get from your Pentothal interview. Your questioning is also very important. I think one of the things which I will say is you need to take a very good history. You need to write down your questions before your Pentothal interview, and you need to ask them in a very nice, poised, calm manner wherein the patient doesn't feel he's being threatened. And the patient then, you know, may come out with this, and your rapport with the patient first has to develop very well. Only then I think the Pentothal interview would be successful.
Yes, absolutely, with proper consent.
Yes.
So then we don't have a full name, but someone called IK says, sir, is there a role of antidepressants in conversion disorder? As we have seen during psychotherapy, patients undergo ab reaction and develop subsyndromal depressive and anxiety symptoms, which I think you have actually tackled.
I think you would start antidepressants in any patient with conversion disorder. And if you feel the depressive features increase during therapy, you would adjust the dose. If you feel anxiety features increase, you would adjust the dose of benzodiazepines or whatever you feel as the patient progresses. So there is a role, no doubt.
Manish Tale is asking, sir, what is the difference between hysterical psychosis and conversion disorder and the management of hysterical psychosis?
Well, I think, like I mentioned, in any psychosis, you would also see some psychotic symptoms apart from just the conversion issue being there. You would see some aggression, you would see some loss of ties with reality and multiple other things. From a clinical perspective, I would, you know, consider management of a combination of antidepressant, antipsychotic, or anti-anxiety, antipsychotic in those cases, rather than primarily conversion, where I don't think antipsychotics would rarely be used. So that I think would be the difference from a management point. Psychotherapy at times may be tough in a patient with hysterical psychosis where there is no insight into the illness. So that is one area where I think psychotherapy as a treatment gets ruled out a bit in those cases.
Then Sanjeev is asking, DSM-5 shows a complete change of orientation towards psychodynamics. How do you see that? And I see his hand is also raised. I'm hoping it's for the same question.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I think, psychodynamics has always been there and it's always going to be there. And I don't think nothing takes away psychodynamics from psychiatry. So I always have mentioned that I always believe that the patient is like a box of chocolates, and you know, each chocolate is a different facet. So one chocolate is the psychodynamics, one is the neurobiology, one is the receptors, one is the neurochemistry, one is the social factors, one is the risk factors. The box of chocolates is the patient itself, and the ribbon around it is the genetics and the epigenetics. So that's how, you know, I look at it. So you have to combine everything together. So there's no way psychodynamics, I don't think we've ever left it out. It's just that I think what I feel is that a lot of postgraduate students have shied away from it and have become more receptor oriented. You don't have a patient that is 5-HT2A deficient or 5-HT1A deficient, but rather you have a patient that you have to look at from a holistic perspective.
I will add to that to say that I think what is happening now is, earlier we did not have exact neuroscience correlates or explanations, neither did we have imaging to explain psychedynamics. It's not that it has disappeared.
True.
Our understanding of it has changed.
Yes, yes, true.
That lens also.
True.
Ashika George is asking, in a person with seizure disorder, how do we diagnose pseudo seizures? Which what she wants to ask particularly is, when in terms of up or down titration of the antiepileptic. So should you change doses in a patient who has both seizures and pseudo seizures? And of course, how do you diagnose them?
Okay, now the two questions are different. One is that you will use a video EEG, which I think is a gold standard. And if you see a muscle artifact when the patient convulses, it goes in favor of pseudo seizures versus a seizure like EEG pattern. So that's our gold standard. I think in a patient that already has epilepsy and is maintained on anti-epileptics, I would not alter the anti-epileptic dose. You know, if he develops pseudo seizures, I would rather put him on anti-anxiety and antidepressants, and the stressor would be managed. So the anti-epileptic dose remains as it is. I wouldn't want to alter that at all, because there is always a risk of him getting seizures actually. So that I think would not be changed at all. So don't uptitrate or downtitrate anything. Let that remain at, if he's seizure free or fit free for any amount of years, 2 years, 3 years, let that dose remain as it is, and manage the pseudo seizures when they come up.
What is the role of hypnosis in the management?
Well, I don't think I'm the right person to answer that, because I, you know, don't use hypnosis in my practice. But from people, I mean, who I've spoken to give you an example, we have Dr. Shauna Kajinkya, who's a psychiatrist who also does a lot of hypnotherapy work in his practice. And he does tell me that hypnosis helps. I have sent him a few patients where the patients have asked for hypnosis as a therapy, and it has worked. So I think, you know, a hypnotherapist, they do talk about hypnotherapy having a role in management of conversion. But I still think I wouldn't be the right person to, you know, comment on, because I have no experience there.
All right. And Praveen is going to send you a case report of using paradoxical intention for tremors. Avinash.
Please, right? Please, no problem. Please send it. No worries at all.
You have Avinash giving you an open invitation. So kind.
Yeah.
You go ahead and send that. IK again. Imtiaz. Okay. He just wanted to, because he had put his name down as like, because I'm the. I think we all will agree that was a wonderful session and a good question and answer round also. It was lovely.
Alka, can I have one question?
Yes, of course, please.
Yeah.
Please, yes.
By change of orientation, what I meant was, it has completely disregarded the primary gains, secondary gains and all that.
Right.
So how do you explain that?
Sir, I will put it this way. DSM may have disregarded it. We haven't disregarded it, you know. So we still do, you know, clinically look at primary gain and secondary gain always. I mean, we do look at it when we clinically look at patients, you know. So I don't know. I mean, I don't think what DSM has done is, it has sort of, it has believed that, you know, conversion as a diagnosis also came with a lot of stigma. And they believe that, you know, one of the reasons, if there is an American Journal of Psychiatry editorial that talks about why conversion has been changed to functional neurological symptom disorder. And they say there are three reasons for that. One is that a diagnosis of conversion cuts off the patient's chances at getting good medical care. They believe that, you know, you tend to then keep looking at the patient as conversion. So, or he's probably, his symptoms are not important. So that functional neurological symptom adds a little dignity to the diagnosis of conversion. They believe in that. Secondly, they've not done away with the primary gain, secondary gain thing, but they primarily believe that there is a more, they have a more, the focus is on ruling out a medical condition. The focus is on, and the second focus is that they say the stressor is not always necessary, which, you know, earlier was a requirement that you need to have an identifiable stressor. They say now it's not needed. And very importantly, even ruling out feigning was something that they've not asked for now. So they've changed the criteria a bit. That's why. So that's why you don't see primary gain and secondary gain in the criteria anymore, you know. But in clinical explanations, it is still there. It's not that textbooks have done away with it, you know. It's.
I think the issue of primary gain and secondary gain is where the pattern is. If you don't find a single thing which you can standardize, it somehow takes its way out of the criteria or guidelines. There's no thing that we have done away with it as a concept. So what we are working towards most of the end out of the guidelines across everyone is to diagnose this as conversion. This is very rightly that functional cortical syndrome disorder is more acceptable, and more acceptable more so to insurance companies, which is where Western medicine and practice comes in. So I think that's why this possibly has been slightly done away with. And also our understanding of the reasons why this happens is definitely changing as we are able to have functional neuroimaging and activating procedures in the brain to see exactly what is going on. So it, the terminology may change, but the observations, I feel, don't change. That's true. That's what is happening over a period of time. So thank you very much, Avinash. That was a very informative lecture. And Rashmin, thank you. You were very kind to introduce me with so much, which was absolutely not necessary in the beginning. It's been a wonderful evening with two dear friends is what I would like to end by saying. And science won in the end.
Okay.
Great. Thank you very much, Alka. And again, thank Avinash for having jumped in the last moment and filled in for the challenge that we had in terms of a speaker having to opt out. And conversion disorder is a very old term since our own PG days, about 20, 25 years back. And we've heard about it on multiple forums at various platforms and in various formats. But this was clearly a very, very interesting perspective that Avinash shared with us. And we are much richer on account of it. And clearly, it was a very popular topic because we had 70 plus resident doctors and senior faculty from across the country chipping in. And that is a measure of Avinash's popularity. So thank you once again. And thank you again, Alka, for making the time for this program. And of course, all the participants who took the time out and who actually made this program and many other such programs the success that it has always been. And it would be remiss on my part to not thank Sun Pharma for having provided us the unstinting support that they have always done during this entire 5+ years of our association with postgraduate activities. So thank you all once again. And I hope you shall continue to participate in our events in the future as well. And we promise to bring you more and more interesting programs in the future. And it's our endeavor to see that academic activity should not be restricted to national CMEs. Even these small personalized interactions go a long way in making some kind of a meaningful dialogue between the faculty and the residents relevant in today's fast-paced academic times. So we hope to continue to work in that direction going forward as well. Thank you all once again, and I wish you a pleasant evening ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.